guys, Jeff Cavalier, ATHLEAN-X.com. Today, I want to talk to you guys about protein absorption and the controversy that was sparked by the video I did about my 61-gram meal of protein in the morning, with lots of people saying, but Jeff, isn't it true that only 30 grams of protein is the max amount that you can absorb in a single meal? That is a bodybuilding myth that has been perpetuated for far too long, and I felt like it deserved its own video to try to break it down as easily as we could to show you that this is simply not true. Okay, there is no magic 30 gram limit. Matter of fact, it could be much, much higher than that. So the first thing we have to understand is, where did this all come about in the first place? A lot of it came from research that showed that protein was absorbed differently depending upon the source of the protein. So some of the research showed, believe it or not, that at the high end here, there was a pork mixture that got absorbed at about 10 grams per hour. Okay, and that whey protein, which we know is a highly absorbable form of protein, came in the 7 to 9 grams or so per hour rate. Then we had our chicken that was somewhere in the 5 grams per hour rate. Okay, and then we know that we had egg protein that was only being absorbed at 1.2 grams per hour. Right? The next piece of information that we know is that the average transit between the stomach through the small intestines is about 6 hours. So what the researchers did, who came up with this magic number, God knows how long ago, is they basically took an average, knowing that protein transit rate is somewhere between 1 and 10 grams an hour, with an average being around 5, and a total transit distance or length and time of 6 hours, you've got 6 times 5, that's 30. So basically at 30 grams, you can no longer absorb any of this. You can no longer digest that other remaining extra protein. Well, there's a couple problems with this, guys. First of all, right here, these numbers were widely varied because the methods that they collected this information were varied. Basically, you've got some studies that were doing this through a direct infusion into the blood of these protein sources versus some with oral ingestion. We know that that can dramatically change the outcome of these studies. So, first of all, this might all be flawed in the first place. And then secondly, we know that transit time can really vary as well based on even the training state and when you're ingesting your food. A lot of flawed information here. And another thing you can do just with your own critical eye is say to yourself, well, hold on a second. If egg protein is only 1.2 grams per hour, does that mean that if you have 24 grams of protein from eggs, which is not all that much, as I showed you in the video the other day, that's only about 6 or 7 egg whites, that that's going to take you over 24 hours to digest? So right off the bat, you start to think, there's something wrong here. So, number two, we have to make sure that we clarify a major difference between the words protein absorption and protein utilization. Absorption is the ability of your body to take it into the bloodstream and start using it somewhere, somehow, some way. Utilization is actually using it for the purposes that we're looking at here, and that's utilized towards new muscle growth, new protein synthesis. That's really, if you're a guy lifting weights, probably your primary concern. Well, let's take a look at a quick little drawing here. Here is a guy, okay, that's me with my big nose here, okay? He's got his esophagus down into the stomach, okay, and then off of the stomach, into the small intestine, okay? The beginning part of the small intestine, that's the duodenum. That's where a lot of our absorption occurs. But in the digestive process, you eat some protein, your saliva starts to break things down a little bit. It goes down into the stomach. Here is where the action starts. We have our hydrochloric acid that's going to break our protein down into its constituent amino acids, some little bit of larger chains, dipeptides, tripeptides, but eventually they start to flow into the duodenum here. And that's where a lot of our absorption is going to occur. And as I said, absorption is a much different concept than utilization. We're going to absorb almost all of the protein that we bring in. Our bodies, guys, we're not stupid. It leads us into our next point. Our humans have survived for a long time for a reason. Our bodies are adaptive. They're not stupid. You're going to absorb almost all of it. If you didn't, if you thought that if you had an 80-gram meal that you can only absorb about 30, you're basically passing 50 grams right through and out the other way. You got 50-gram mini steaks coming out your ass if you think that that's what's going to actually occur. So in actuality, when we're talking about absorption, we do get a high rate of absorption because what happens are these dipeptides and the constituent amino acids do get taken up into the bloodstream, but something happens right there. We have a first pass metabolism. It takes that through, again, just the absorption through the small intestine. The small intestine uses a lot of those amino acids for itself and its own protein synthesis, as does the liver. It also uses it for its own protein synthesis. So what you're left with is not what you brought in. 30 grams are not coming all the way through to be utilized by the muscles. You're left with a lot smaller percentage of what your initial intake was to actually be utilized by the muscles. So that's one concept. Now, the next thing we have to talk about, as I said, humans are smart. So we were, based on our forefathers, were out there hunting and gathering in spurts. We would take in and maybe get access to a meal that had 150 grams of protein, if we were so lucky back as a caveman, to eat that and then allow maybe 24 or 48 hours before we ever found another meal again. If you think that we only digested 30 grams of that and the rest was gone, we never would have lived this long. So studies now show and support that, very interestingly, if you have 150 grams of protein in one meal, okay, one meal, versus 30 grams of protein in five meals spread throughout the day, the overall nitrogen excretion, which would be a measure of the waste of the protein, and also protein synthesis, stayed the same. It's the same between the two, in one meal versus in five meals. So it kind of threw that whole myth about a maximum amount being necessary for you to realize any gains and benefits from it. But we have to understand, it's not, muscle growth is not all about protein, guys. It should never all be about protein. And when you think, because this might support those that believe intermittent fasting is the way to go, because they're saying, well, I'll just get all my food in one shot, or at least in a very consolidated window, and then I won't have to worry about eating for all those other hours of the day, versus the guy that says he wants to eat 5 to 6 times a day. And people will say that that is support for that not being the ideal way to eat. Doing so ignores an entirely different concept here, guys, and that is blood sugar stability. Okay, the stability of your blood sugar is paramount, I believe, to realizing long-term muscle gains by looking at the big picture. Okay, if we look at just protein in isolation, we know that that really doesn't have an impact on our blood sugar. But that's not how we eat. We don't ever really eat protein in isolation. And if you are, I can tell you have a pretty boring and bland diet that likely you're not going to be able to stick to for very long. We usually eat foods in combination. Proteins and carbohydrates together are going to have an impact on our blood sugar and the way we feel. So if you go and you feel that you're going to eat all of your meals in one consolidated time frame because from a protein standpoint it's not going to have a difference, it is going to have a major difference on how your brain perceives that type of approach to eating. And I'm not talking about here any impact on metabolism. That's long ago been a myth that's been dispelled. We're not talking about the metabolism boosting effects of a stable blood sugar. We're talking about the delivery of blood glucose to your brain and its ability to keep you functioning at your best, and how that will relate to your workouts in a long term. Because your brain thrives on having a consistent delivery of glucose, its primary fuel, to operate at its best. And when your brain is not operating at its best, you can feel fatigued. You can feel irritable, you can feel even dizzy, right? Low energy. How are you going to attack your workouts with your best intensity if your brain is low on blood sugar? If your brain is suffering from the primary fuel it craves, you're not going to. So think about the long-term implications of that on your training. So guys, all in all, I feel as if sometimes we put the cart before the horse. If you are concentrating so much on the minutia of, oh, I can't eat 35 grams of protein or more, or 30 grams of protein, or oh my God, if I eat 65 grams of protein, I'm going to basically turn into an onion or something. Something weird's going to happen to me. A lot of times I find guys putting the complicated things, the minutia, in front of the big picture because it makes avoiding the big picture a lot easier. If I can focus on the things that are going to take a lot more work, it confuses the matter, and it makes it a lot easier for me to just say, well, you know what, I can't really do it because it's so confusing, even the researchers don't know what they're doing. That's not how it goes, guys. For me in particular, I have found that a boost of protein, eating 60 grams of protein or so in the morning, has worked well for me. Again, this is going to vary. Even the upper range of protein, there is a daily range, most likely, to what you can take in a day. But it so varies depending upon the size of the individual, their experience weight training, when they're taking in their protein. There's a lot of factors that come in to why the body responds a certain way to it. But for me, I find that getting a consistent delivery of protein, having carbohydrates, I believe carbohydrates are a very important part of our daily diets, they should not be avoided. Having those two come in together, getting a consistent flow of nutrients in my body, keeping my blood sugar stable throughout the day, keeping my energy level stable so that I can attack my workouts with intensity, relying on higher protein options, like my RX supplements that allow me to get my protein a little bit easier, and sort of having a whole simplified approach to eating. For me, it's simple. For me, it's very easy for me to do. I find that that's been effective for me. What happens with you is a much different story. But, as I always say here, guys, if you want a simplified approach, if you want to follow a plan that breaks it down, literally I give you exactly what I do. Meal by meal, exactly what I eat. That video was just a sneak peek into what I do, but I don't eat the same thing every single day. So there's other meal options and things that of how I utilize my proteins and how I combine things together and exactly how I supplement. All of the information I put in our ATHLEAN-X training program, if you want to get a day-by-day, step-by-step approach to nutrition to finally start making it simple, then you can do that at ATHLEAN-X.com. Just grab my 90-day training program. I always say it's mine because it literally is based off of what I do and what I've done with my athletes that I know works. And again, you can focus on trying to rely on old dogma or old myths to make it a lot more confusing and to slow down your ultimate progression, but I don't think we have to make it that complicated, guys. So there you go, there you have it. Hopefully this video was helpful. If you found it helpful, make sure you leave a thumbs up and some comments below. In the meantime, we'll be back here again in just a couple days with more videos. Let me know what you want to see, and I'll make sure that I bring them to you. Thanks, guys.